Dr. Ajai, I'm first of all very honored to be talking to you. You are an inspiration and role model for everyone in this country. You're a doctor, you came back from US and you started HCG, which is making, from what I know of you, you're making cancer care affordable, which is a very, very big requirement in a country like ours. So I just want you to quickly, for everyone, tell us your story.
I'm from Bangalore, did my medicine here in St. John's. At that time in 1970s, because the technology was not here, we all felt there was a gap in our higher studies in medicine. So all of us, interest was to go abroad. Yeah. So in 1975, we used to get green card at home. You take the exam and it comes home. So I immigrated to US to do higher studies. Fortunately, I was able to do it in one of the best centers in the world. Even today, it is number one. It's the largest cancer center, MD Anderson in Houston. So I was able to do my residency fellowship there. So there I learned a lot about cancer care. It was one of a game changer for me. When I looked at cancer care at that time, where it was felt, right treatments were not there, hopeless situation, cancer patients were called victims,
yeah.
And survivors, any name we use, and lot of names like terminal care were used. I like challenges. Even in my med school or even primary school, I always like challenges. Like one time, I remember in seventh grade, one of my classmates was beaten by a teacher. So I created a delegation of students. We went to the head of the institution and made him remove the teacher.
Wow.
So like that, always underdogs, I always fought. And also I grew up in a family where a lot of value systems were important. My dad was dean of law school. We used to have evening discussions on political field of India, world. And we had a lot of discussion on, left, right. At that time, there were a lot of leftist movements. We all talked. So we grew up in such an environment. Challenges were important for me. And when I saw cancer patients, even though I wanted to be a cardiologist, when I saw what was happening to cancer patients in my rotationship in Virginia University, I decided I should take it up as a challenge, because I saw patients laying in corners with pain,
yeah.
And people saying there's no treatment available. That's why I chose to go to MD Anderson, which is considered mecca of oncology. With that, the journey began. So the director offered me that you can be head of the lung program and all. Then he also offered me you can go and head a center in Saudi Arabia. They were building a center in Saudi, MD Anderson. I said, no. I would go to India. So I decided someday I want to move to India and I want to learn the ropes of putting your own center. So that is how the next journey began, of me learning to put a center on my own, which I did outside of Chicago, 3 hours west of Chicago. And I got partners. Through that, I told my partners I have to spend 3 months in India at least. That is the agreement I had. So I started spending 3 months in India in 1980s. I took off 6 months really to travel across India and understand. And it was a great learning because I knew the high technology, yeah. What was happening. Then I come to India and see cobalt treatment, very low end. Why is this happening? Everybody said we are a poor country. So I always took the view, cancer doesn't know poor or rich.
Yeah.
It only knows one thing, right way to treat. Because we are a poor country, Canadian government manufactures cobalt for so-called poor countries, but not a single Canadian is treated with cobalt. Why? I asked that question to one of the manufacturers. He didn't have an answer. So why are we accepting poor quality machines? And even today people are. So I was aghast with this. It really was an eye-opener for me, and it really made me determine that I should come back to India. The question was when. So I started, I always plan ahead. So I started putting plan. Like all young oncologists in India, I was doing very good there. Great practice. People came from 100 miles. Dr. Ajai means some people thought I can walk on water because so many. I had turned around the whole community with cancer care. So, but when I thought about it, coming to India, I said, let me do not-for-profit. So I developed a trust in US. US government gave me tax-free to build a cancer center in India. Can you believe that?
Wow.
US government, not for US, for India. So 50% I could donate. So I started doing that. and build a center in Mysore. When I started building, I realized, how can I depend on grants? How can I depend on people to always, you know, please pay me, give me money, I'm doing great service.
Yeah.
I am not that. I don't have that DNA.
Yeah.
So that is when I said, let us start in a private enterprise. Let us have cross-subsidy and see how we can make it value-based medicine. Value-based medicine is clearly means what costs $10 in US, $7 or $8 in Europe, can I do it for $3 and get the same outcome? Same technology can I bring? That was the challenge. People thought I will fail because there's no way you can bring expensive technology here, do all that, and the paying capacity is not there.
Yeah.
How will they be? So cost, people always talked about cost, but nobody talked about outcomes. Everybody wanted cheap medicine, but not outcome medicine, good outcome from the treatment. So this is what I took up on. And fortunately, after starting the Mysore, Bangalore Institute of Oncology, first private center with a group of doctors, oncologists in Bangalore, who are still my partners, majority of them. Together we started this, and I learned a lot over the next 8 to 10 years, how is it going to function. When I brought in LINAC here, you won't believe, people were opposed. Even oncologists, my friends, opposed. They said, no way India can take LINAC. Only few hospitals had.
Mm.
I said, no, I'll bring it. With great difficulty, we brought it with Siemens. The interest rates were 20%. There's no way. So I made an agreement with Siemens at 5% interest. I went to Germany, met the board, said, look, this is the time, I will be your partner for a long time. They said, okay, take it at 5%, let us see. And I did.
Yeah.
Because we all come from middle class families. We are not wealthy parents or wealthy father-in-law. We don't have anything like that, you know. We are all self-made.
Yeah.
So with that, when I started doing it here, majority of the patients chose LINAC.
Mm.
We were charging 10,000, 15,000 for cobalt for the whole 6 weeks. When we started charging 30,000, 40,000, because LINAC is a lot of consumables and all, 70% people moved. So that, my colleagues also realized, you know what? People want good care.
Yeah.
That is what they want. Cost is there, but good care is important. So ultimately, with that, I started creating a model. And somehow, I gave up my practice. I told my wife, one day I walked into a house from my work. I said, look, she was pregnant with twins then. I said, I want to leave and go back to India. And she said, at least wait till I deliver. So the kids were born in October of 2000. So that year, I left there. And then my wife was an artist. She's an artist. So she had to do some work in Boston. So we were in Boston. I had this nice place bought. I said, I'll spend 6 months in India. I had all the plans. But when I started coming to India, 2001-2002, I realized I have to be here. So again, I woke up my wife one day at 2 o'clock in the morning. I went for a walk on the ocean and came back. She said, why are you waking me? I got to sell this house. I got to do all this and move to India. She said, she just looked at me shocked. Just now we got this house, which was on the ocean.
Yeah.
I said, no, sorry, I can't live here. So we decided to sell. She was very supportive, very, very. So we decided to sell. And she had to do her master's program in Chicago. So she went there to do, and I moved to India with kids, with my twins and my son, and my daughter, first one later on joined. So with that, really the journey of HCG began. 2003, I met Gans, who was a businessman who was doing something in India. He also had a passion to do something in molecular diagnostics. He has started a small group called Triesta. So together we came. He said, why don't we join? You know, I was already running a hospital. I said, yeah, maybe, you know, I'm interested in research. That was my passion, to do something deep down, go back, research. So it was great. So together we started putting the plan. Then I didn't know what it is to... I knew I couldn't borrow at that high interest rate. So I told Gans one day, Gans, I can't borrow. I can't do all this. I want to create this sensor of excellence, cyclotron, PET scan, cyber knife. I said, doctor, there's a way of doing it. I said, what? Let us go and ask private equity. I said, private equity? Well, how will they fund? No, they want some return. Maybe they will give equity. So when we went, nobody said, healthcare. That took focused cancer care is a disaster. Because right then, Week magazine had come up with a cover story. Which are the specialties which will do good? Best was cardiology, orthopedics. The worst was oncology. So they said, so nobody will invest. I said, anyway, we'll ask for some. So we went knocking on the door, like you see in the movies. I got a plan, you know, and the guy used to say, shut the door. Sorry, we don't want you. So we went for several. And then I said, I told the Khans, I'm exhausted. I don't know. Don't worry, doctor. Let us keep doing it. He was very persistent. Finally, we met IDFs. There was one Luis Miranda. He was from Chicago. He had done his MBA from Chicago University. Very nice guy. He and his group met me. And through Satish Mandana, Satish Shenoy, who was our investment banker. Initially, they said, we do roads. I don't know whether we could do this. Then I gave him the whole spiel, how we can expand to 10 centers and all that. He was like, you know, let me think about it. And then he came and visited me in Chicago. Well, I still have a place in Chicago. I had on the lake. He came and visited. I wanted to see your family, how you have dinner with your family. He sat down at dinner. Yeah. So he checked me out. Then he said, I'm going to give you $10 million, no conditions. I got 3 term sheets, but all of them had conditions. If you achieve this, I'll give you this. If you achieve this, you can get. I told my team, look, I'm an oncologist. I will do what is best for the patient. Every day morning, I cannot think, what is the revenue? What is the achievement so I can do? I can't have that stress because I want to do the right thing for the patient.
Yeah.
So with that, what Luis and the IDF gave was ideal. Unconditional $10 million with certain valuation. Even though whatever the valuation I accepted, I got diluted. But I didn't mind. So with that, in a few years, I had this model of hub and spoke. So we created the hub, which is in Bangalore, and put in cyclotron. I'd already started the cyclotron process and then brought in CyberKnife. Made it a true center of excellence like MD Anderson with doctors. 100 doctors are there almost now. And then created spokes, few of them, about 5 or 6, within few years, with partner model like Nasik, Vijayawada, using doctors, oncologists there, Dr. Raj Nagarkar, Dr. Gopichand, very nice, good doctors, oncologists. So that model worked very well. So with this came second private equity, Evolvins. Then came Premji. And Premji called me. I thought he wanted to discuss some business deal. So I went to him. He heard me. You know, I made a presentation thinking he wants to see what I am doing. You know? Then he says, I have checked you out for your ethics and transparency. You are highly recommended. I am impressed with your background. I want to invest with you. At that time, I didn't need. You know, I was just trying to finish the first $10 million. He said, no, I want to invest with you. Then, you know, I kept quiet. Then he said, what do you say? I said, okay, Mr. Premji, if you say, fine. So for a year, they did my scrubbing diligence. After that, they invested. And that again, you know, propelled me to higher. Mm-hmm. And with all that, we grew to almost 14, 15 centers and few, 2 or 3 multi-speciality by 2016. That is when Evolvins got exited. And all of them got good exits. And others came and bought. There was also Milestone Religare which came. With that, I felt we are ready to the idea of what Satish had going public. Said, you know, maybe we should go public. Enough of private equity. Let's go public. So the board was also supportive because we had set some guidelines. When are we going to go public? So we were meeting those. And I thought it is also a great journey, you know, a oncology center, entrepreneur, doctor, taking some company public. That is a great thing. Coming with no help from anybody, only us doctors group. So I felt very proud of it. So I said, so in 16 March, we went public. By that time, we also had Dr. Kamini Rao as a partner for our IVF fertility. She also is an entrepreneur who wanted to do similar like HCG, hub and spoke across India, and she loved our model. I said, why not encourage entrepreneur? That was part of my game plan always, encourage other doctors, entrepreneurs. Because doctors have to become entrepreneurs. You know, in the end, I don't think business people are making this statement, my personal statement, should run healthcare institutions because they run it for wrong reasons.
Yeah.
It should be doctors, and the most successful models are doctors, if you look at India. I don't think anywhere in the world you'll see a tire manufacturer going into hospital or a liquor barons going into hospital or an industry, some steel magnet. Wrong reasons they're going. Because we have to look at what is the right thing for the patient. We have to be patient-centric. And I feel very clearly it's the doctor's vision which knows what how to do healthcare at a ground zero level and improve. We focus on quality, outcome, and, you know, cost, everything we combine together to make it. So that is why, you know, there has been a lot of publicity, the cost, and I'll come to that in a minute. But having gone public, now we have executed, completed 21 oncology, soon to be 26 oncology centers, 4 or 5 multi-speciality, about 10 IVF. So globally, we are in oncology the largest. Except for parts of Uttar Pradesh, Kashmir, and maybe Bihar, patients can get up and say morning, go to a cancer center of HCG, come back and sleep in their own bed. And high-end centers, wow. You take Ranchi, Nasik, Vijayawada, Vizag, or Shumoga, Tier 3 city. In everywhere, we have dedicated oncology center, comprehensive. So nobody like this in the globally exists. So this is, in a nutshell, I've explained to you my journey and the healthcare in India.
No, doctor, very, very impressive and very inspiring. You know, one question when you were talking, one that clearly comes across is that you're very passionate. And but, you know, I was just talking that you wear two hats, one of an entrepreneur,
yeah,
who has got private equity money. And of course, the everyone is looking at you that you have to return the money. And one is that you're dealing with India with its own reality, where most people come without money, and you have, and you're doing a lot of charity and free treatments. How do you combine both the hats?
See, first thing is when private equity come, when they came to me also, I was very clear, I can't give you the moon. Because I remember having a breakfast with a private equity firm in New York. They said, you know, doctor, we expect 25% higher return. I said, oh, really? He said, yeah. Thank you for the breakfast. I said, I got up and left. I just left. I can, no way I can meet your needs. Because we have to promise what we can deliver.
Yeah.
See, my bank loan may be 10%, 12%. I can maybe give it 15% or 16%. That's all. I tell everyone, I can't guarantee, but if things work out okay, you will get better. Fortunately, most of them have got better return. They are happy. But our expectation, I always keep it, what is realistic. That can be achieved by simple measures like centralization, making sure, you know, bulk purchase, how we do. All of that gives you that little bit of margin, which is somewhat above the bank rates, so you can, and also we work with manufacturers. See, whatever equipment we get, we try to get a certain period, where we don't have to pay interest or principal. So in that period, we expect the center to grow. So we have created a model where we don't stress the system that much, and the cash flows and all are done, manage it. So we, through this prudent, fiscally conservative, I always value private equity money more than my own. That's what. $1 of that is worth much more than my own, because the value, I have to make sure their money is preserved, their money is returned properly with what their expectation is. As long as their expectation is something we both of us agreed is realistic, if they are high, I tell them, please don't invest here, because I can't deliver. You can go to some IT or startup or Flipkarts, you can invest, but not us. So we have to be very, you know, clear. And we cannot give a false, that is what has happened sometimes. I see some other institutions where they give this big, I remember somebody writing, I'll give you 20% return, and they otherwise they can drag and tag along and do all this. They're going through hell now,
wow,
some of the institutions, because they can't deliver that much.
Yeah.
So why you want to put yourself in this? You know, you have to be honest. Yeah. First is you have to be honest to yourself and honest to the investor who is coming, and tell them this is what. Eventually you'll get caught if you don't, if you try to, you know. So I think that is our model has been very clear, you know, being straightforward, honest, transparent, and the community likes that, you know. Our entire, when we went IPO, everything, people loved our integrity, honesty, and they thought that is why some of the value has come. Very marquee investors have come to us because of that.
Yeah.
And hopefully they'll stay with us.
Yeah, I'm sure. Yeah.
And I think the future looks very good. You know, if you look at future globally in an underserved market, and we are in a very good position to, with our model, to really dominate this. We are just putting our bandwidth, our model, using IT, everything in a way so we can capture that. And data management is important. Patients' data, how do we create that? What do we learn from that? and what is the research, that also is very valuable.
Yeah.
So all of this bioinformatics, so all of this, I think India is in a very well position to be a leader, provided certain calamities don't happen. That's all.
Doctor, one question I wanted to ask you is that, are you engaging with startups? Because in India, you know, there are so many amazing people, young people, but they say that they don't get access, right?
You know, actually, we are, it's a good question, we are very much into it. Because me and my daughter Anjali, who has come back from US, she were all born there, and she wants to settle in India, she's working. And very interested in this accelerator program. We have tied up with the Hyderabad group, where we are trying to incubate about 25 people. Incubate,
wow.
Healthcare. We have also invested in few early stage. In fact, Neeraj is also responsible for looking into some early startups in some home care and certain area of certain very research venture, like very early investments,
yeah,
we do.
Yeah.
We are also getting into certain areas like certain apps for home care.
Yeah.
One person has come up with that. We are trying to see whether we should invest with them. We also mentor. Recently, the Brand Capital had a group where I mentored about three startup groups, and I found them very interesting in healthcare. So I am very interested in technology, in some of the newer ideas in healthcare, including some nutraceuticals. You know, we need to do some randomized trials. When somebody comes and says, this is good for cancer, this protein is good, how do you prove, how do you know?
Yeah.
So we say, let us do a trial. And based on the trial, can we show this particular nutrient what you have is good? So we are open the doors for that. So we want to kind of compete with the West on doing proper scientific analysis. You know, people always talk about Ayurveda medicine, homeopathy medicine. But one thing is, compared to the allopathy, none of them do trials. You know, they don't have a trial saying, I had 500 cases of cancer, 250 got this, 250 didn't get.
Yeah.
The whole, none of them do. So you can't go by just anecdotal cases. You have to do trials to see. That is what the West has very well done. And we are also doing a lot of trials. Follow-up is a problem in India. We are putting together some IT systems and all to see the follow-up of patients is done properly. But eventually, if we want to be leaders in research, see, India lacks in research. India, we are very good copycats. Any drug comes out of the West, we can copy in no time. But are we original inventors? We are not. Why? Because when I ask them, because they say we are not, we can't spend that kind of money.
Yeah.
Even if you take IT giants, Infosys and all those, they are body shops. They are not innovators. They don't do research. You know, they do only what other out the West tells you, just do this product and bring it to me. I will assemble everything and do. So research is not happening in India, which is very sad. Medical, non-medical, IT, no research. We need to really spend.
You know, but doctor, see, people like you are hope, right? Like what you have done is an example, and it should spread to many people, because they should know, you know, the impact you creating at your micro level. If people at your position do that and do that genuinely, I think we'll see.
But we have to look at the larger, because small groups doing is not going to help. You know, what has happened in the last 15-20 years still? Only the middle class upper have moved up the ladder. But the purchasing power of this 800-900 million has moved up, but no comparison to what is happening. And that is why we see farmer suicide.
We should get you in to join politics, and you should be in the...
No, I gave a talk about this 3,000 women recently, our women class. I told them, I don't want to be political. I think I can do a lot more better work being outside politics. You know, once you get into politics, it's a different story. But being outside, you know, being talking about it and questioning the system in a positive way.
Yeah.
I never believe in questioning, going after individuals.
Yeah.
I don't think it's a system. It's a system we should go after. Individuals won't help. You know, you are corrupt, you are this. That's not going to help. Why is it corrupt? Because there's a reason. You know?
Yeah.
And what are the consequences of corruption? We don't talk. If somebody is bribed to build a road, the road is bad. That is our problem. The corruption is something.
Yeah.
But the road becomes bad, no?
Yeah.
So we need to look at those. What are the consequences of this? That is the only way we can address. But India, you know, people ask me. I was just in Chicago. I have a place. One of my colleagues was with me. I said, why in the hell did you leave all this and come to me? I said, because we live on our place is on a lake and it looks nice. I was enjoying the view with him. He said, "Why did you leave?" You know, because I said, "You know what? That is where I belong."
No, but this is where you inspire. This is where you've made a, you know, because you've got hope. You know, the general narrative in India is that, you know, especially in the class which you can afford, is like, oh, if you have money for treatment, we'll have to go outside, right? If there's something happens. Now, today, what you've done is like, okay, cancer care can be treated here.
And also, we get people from Africa, Middle East, South Africa patients come. Wow. Because they see it as a center of excellence, not just the cost difference. Center of excellence, because we just treated a lady from South Africa. She got her eyeball removed because her tumor had grown, and she was so thankful. She said, you know, this kind of care, she wanted to take pictures with us, never get there. You know, because we as Indians, you know, I don't know, Harvard review showed as people who get treated by Indian doctors live longer in US. So we are very clear, we know that kind of empathy, compassion, and going into details, we do a much better job. But we still suffer from this colonization effect. You know, like you might have read the book, Shashi Tharoor's, you know, Era of Darkness. You ever read it? That is clear. I am a believer in that. I think we suffer from colonization. We suffer from this white man syndrome. And we need to get rid of it. Any conferences I have now, I say no foreign speakers. No, we will do it ourselves, run the hard way.
Wow. Yeah.
Painful way. Yeah. No shortcuts. You know, people tell me we have to bring somebody from America. Why? We don't have any pride. Somebody came to me, I'm having a conference, I'm having this international speaker. In that case, I'm not supporting you. I don't know. We can do it ourselves.
Yes.
You know,
yes,
we are good.
I believe in the same. Yes.
Yeah, why not?
Yes. Yes.
This business of all this is, I think it's not correct. But let it be painful. Let us go through.
You know, Doctor, I'm loving talking to you. It's amazing. I'm sure all entrepreneurs and everyone who will watch this will be very inspired.
Most painful way is the best way. Yeah. Like, I'm a marathon runner. I've done 7 Chicago marathons. Each marathon is painful, but I do it because at the end of the day, you know, I completed it. The long haul, you
and
know.
You like challenges.
Yeah, you like. I feel good. So, yeah. When somebody tells me, let us go an easy way, I said, that's low-hanging fruit. I don't want. Let us take the hard way and do it the right way, you know.
Yeah.
That is the right way, hard way. And the path is more important than the goal.
Yeah.
You know, the goal is a moving target.
Yeah.
You know? So the path you take.
Yeah.
The right, it's okay. I remember telling my wife when I said, I'm going to India, we'll go sell the house. I said, I just have to say this, sorry, but I may become a coolie in a bus stand, but you have to put up with me because I'm going to start all this through entrepreneur. She was shocked.
Whom did I marry? Now, doctor, now that we've got hold of you, one thing which is like, you know, there's a lot of fear in the minds of people because cancer is spreading a lot. And suddenly, you know, you hear, all of us hear someone got cancer. Now, age is no bar. What do you have to tell people about?
I think my usual mantra is very clear. Fear is our worst enemy. Cancer is not your worst enemy. Fear. If you don't have fear, if you say, I will conquer this disease, you can't. It is a question of positive mind. Like, I have multiple examples of patients who are positive. Like, I have this lady who's in Dubai now. She is the wife of a big businessman. 10 years ago, she came with extensive disease. One thing she had was positive attitude. So we treated her for breast cancer. She didn't want surgery. We did CyberKnife, did very good. She went into brain, treated her. She's alive, doing very good, very active socially. And, you know, she's also one of our persons who talks, like a pink cope group we have.
Yeah.
So the entire group we have is about positive approach. And if you don't have fear, say, let us, okay, diseases come to me. I'll take it in a positive way. I'll fight this disease. I think it is conquerable. You can conquer. And, you know, you may not be cured. So many diabetes we don't cure, blood pressure we don't cure, asthma we don't cure, majority of the diseases we don't cure. So why cancer is always associated with cure? Because we have used the cancer name illegitimately. We have used somebody has corruption, it's a cancer of the society. Somebody is doing some robbery, cancer, this is what. We cannot use the word. You know, we have to be very clear, cancer as a different definition. It should be used properly. And we, as doctors also, we should stop using stage 4, stage palliative care. That causes fear.
Yeah.
You know, somebody with a stage 4 cancer with one lesion in the bone is also stage 4.
Yeah.
Somebody with extensive disease is also stage 4. One lesion in the bone can live for 8 to 10 years or longer. Whereas one with extensive disease may be a year.
Yeah.
Why, how can we say both are stage 4?
Yeah.
So we have to clearly define where is the disease, how it has spread. Based on that, call it, this is how I can treat. So part of the reason there is so much fear is we as healthcare providers, oncologists or related staff have not done a good job in explaining to the community, to the patient, how cancer is dealt, how it should be treated. And we have not created ambassadors, champion. Like we have Shashi, I mentioned, like ambassador, Amar Bhaskar. We have so many patients who talk about it in our clinic. So we have to create these people who are not willing to come out and talk years ago. Now they are. We have a Tiwari in Delhi who is IAS officer who about to get a breast removed. She came as and we did not. Now 10 years. Just wrote to me a few months back. I'm 10 years now, doctor. Where should I go for a checkup? So, you know, so we have to create people like that who can talk positively. Not seeing movies which are very negative and becoming negative.
Yeah.
That is another problem.
Yeah.
All these movies are so negative on cancer. It is causing a lot of problem. So we have to overcome fear.
Yeah.
We have to overcome fear. We have to face it. And the family support is important. Finances are next. That is also another fear. We have to create a model where financially they can tolerate it without going and borrowing money or selling land.
Doctor, this has been an amazing. I've just got so mesmerized listening to you. Thank you. What
Thanks,
an honor. Thank
thanks.
You so
no,
much.
It has been pleasure. My pleasure.
No.
I always love talking.
But you need to, my request, and this I'm telling on camera, my request is someone like you need to engage a lot more with entrepreneurs, young businesses, because there's so much people will get inspired listening to you. Thank you.
Sure, thank you.
Thanks a lot.